Our text this morning from 1 Thessalonians chapter 1. We will be in verses 2 and 3. 1 Thessalonians 1, verses 2 and 3. We always thank God for all of you, mentioning you in our prayers. We continually remember before our God and Father your work produced by faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. This is the Word of God. Father, as we look to your Word, we ask that you would teach us. You would open our hearts to what you have to say to us today. Amen. Well, did you notice the sermon title? Faith, Love, and Hope. Isn't that out of order? Isn't it mainly faith, hope, and love? We get that from 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13, in the great love chapter. And many of us have memorized 1 Corinthians 13, 13, even if we don't know we've memorized it. Now that's where Paul says, now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is? Yeah, so you've got it. You can say it all day long if you want to, but that'd be kind of boring. And yet here we are, I'm giving the sermon title, Faith, Love, and Hope. It seems that when Paul wrote 1 Corinthians, he is plagiarizing. And he didn't do a good job of it. Because the first place that this triad of Christian virtues, faith, love, and hope, is mentioned is not in 1 Corinthians 13, but actually in 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 3. And Paul was plagiarizing himself, except that a couple years later, he wrote 1 Thessalonians in about 51, 52 AD, about 20 years after the Ascension, and he wrote 1 Corinthians a couple years after that, so he's thinking back when he wrote the Church of Thessalonica, and he mixed it up when he did 1 Corinthians 13. This is the first place in Christian literature where this triad is spoken of, and is spoken of actually as Paul lays out for us examples of what it means to be saved, or three evidences of salvation. And he's going to lay that out for us as he begins to pray for the church. He says, I pray for you always. I give thanks to God as I remember you. And I remember these three characteristics that you have as a church. First, you have work produced by faith. That's the first evidence of salvation. Work produced by faith. Now, this presents a challenge for many of us. Because there is this big issue in the church that's been going on for centuries, and that is, are we saved by faith or are we saved by works? And here, Paul seems to bunch the two together, and he's got works produced by faith, and we scratch our head and say, well, where does Paul fall on this again? Didn't he say something about we're saved by faith, not by works? And that's the whole argument he had with James, because James says, you show me your faith without works, and I'll show you my faith with my works. And so there seems to be in Scripture this tension over works and salvation and how that fits together. And Paul here says, I thank God that one of the evidence of your salvation is that you have work which is produced by faith. That faith must lead to works, but works are faith. And Paul, I believe, is going to pull us into this issue of what does it mean to have faith? And what are the works? Is it doing the Lord's work? Certainly a troubling phrase in this issue of works salvation and the contrast between faith in Christ and the works. The law is stark. And I would agree with the Scripture that we are not saved by the works of the law. And that really is the crux of the issue when it begins to talk about works salvation. Work salvation is when you believe that because you're circumcised or because you were fulfilling the Sabbath or you're obeying the food laws, that as a result of the works of the law, you were saved. And that kind of works is not in question here. So take out those fundamental law-oriented works and begin to see works from the perspective of how our lives are changed as a result of faith. Because true faith in Jesus Christ expresses itself in works. As a matter of fact, Paul is going to go on in this very chapter of 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 9, and he's going to talk about the very first work of faith. This is what it says in verse 9. We're halfway through the verse. They tell you how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God. That the first work of faith is the fact that you turn away from something else in order to have faith. Now, a lot of people in our society don't want to talk about that as being a work of faith, but and they want to make it like faith is somehow easy. But I'll submit to you, faith is not easy. That there is a significant portion of our faith which is work, which is very intentional. It's very much that we have made a decision to embrace a particular viewpoint and a worldview as opposed to other worldviews. And once you embrace one worldview, you, by virtue of that, have chosen against other worldviews. It is a work of faith to have faith, because we turn from idols in order to believe in the living God. So when we begin to think in terms of what happens at salvation, one of the evidences of salvation is that we're willing to say no to stuff that does not gel with our faith. One of the works of faith is the fact that we choose to believe, for instance, that the Scripture says that God created the heaven and the earth. And so we choose an act of faith that says we believe in creation. That means we don't choose the act of faith which the evolutionists choose. They choose to believe, they have this faith in the ability of evolution across species. You know, and I suggest to you, when you're talking to someone who says that they believe in science, not faith, you know, to remind them that they still have to believe in something. And science changes a whole lot more than faith changes. Because science tells you eggs are bad for you this year, and next year eggs are good for you, salt is bad for you, salt is good for you, or maybe the right kind of salt, you know, are you supposed to have a low carb or a high, you know, no matter what it is, science keeps on changing. Their opinions keep changing after, you know, over time. The way we treated illnesses 100 years ago is dramatically different than the way we treat illnesses today. So we have faith in science. You know, that's a great argument for people. You know, when people say, "I don't believe, you know, in this faith stuff," you say, "No, you believe in faith in science. You have faith. You still, at some point, take a position of faith." And if you don't think that faith is work, I want to remind you of something most of you have done. In the first service, actually, only one person had not done this. So you remember when you were probably in high school, maybe in college, the exercise where you were in a group and you have to stand and you stand with your back to someone and they say, "Okay, what you're going to do, you're going to trust the person behind you and you're going to fall backwards." Okay? Now, you know that? Have any of you never done that? Raise your hand. If you've never done that, raise your hand. Okay, Glenda, come on up here. You see, that same thing happened in the first service. Because she knew that if she was going to come up here, she was going to be asked to make the work of faith, to stand in front of a bunch of people and fall backwards in the hopes that I liked her enough to catch her. That's the way it is with faith. You see, you can do it. Glenda could do it. She could come up here and make a decision that she was going to override her fear of falling backwards, and she was going to override that by trusting the person standing behind her. I don't know what to think about the fact that she doesn't trust me enough to do that, but see, it's a work of faith to have faith. So Paul says to us that one of the evidences of salvation is that we have work produced by faith. Because there are times in your life when you're going to read the Scripture and you're going to look around you and you're going to say, "It doesn't seem to match up. It doesn't seem as though faith is true." But let me tell you, appearances can be deceiving. And it's a work of faith to continue to affirm that which the Scripture says. We do it intentionally. We do it intentionally because we weigh out and we say, we recognize, particularly in the area of science, that much of what was supposedly scientifically proven is false. And you can quote me on that. We don't always know what things science has supposedly proven which are false. And there are many, many things where our faith and science agree. But there are also places where we make a decision. We will either be people of faith or we will be people who have no faith. We will either affirm what the Scripture says or we will choose to ignore what the Scripture says. And when we choose to affirm it, we are performing a work of faith. Now, there's another thing. The word work that is used in this passage is actually also used in 1 Corinthians 15:58, and it speaks specifically of a particular type of work which is produced by faith, and that is the work which we generally would call ministry. And so we were able to observe a number of people today who were involved in a work of faith. They include Sharon and the worship team. Individuals who had made a decision that on the basis of their faith, they would perform certain ministries, certain works. And Paul admonishes us to choose a ministry, to be involved in something which shows that we have faith. It doesn't have to be a dramatic ministry. It doesn't have to be an upfront ministry. But I would suggest to you that the Scripture consistently says that if you are people of faith, you ought to be involved in some type of Christian ministry. Maybe it's a Christian ministry of feeding the homeless. Maybe it's a Christian ministry of picking up pieces of paper which have been dropped on the floor of church. It doesn't really matter what the ministry is, but you do it for God. It's produced by faith, a work produced by faith. So there's two aspects of this work produced by faith which Paul is speaking of here. The one is that intentional decision to act in a manner which is consistent with Christian beliefs, and the other is a decision to do particular ministries for God. And those are part of evidences of salvation. Paul goes on then and he says that we have love prompted, or labor prompted by love. This labor prompted by love is an interesting phrase because it's easy to get mixed up, especially when we think in terms of faith, love, and hope as it relates to 1 Corinthians 13, because many of us, when 1 Corinthians 13, we read that, we think faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love, and it must be love towards God. But within the context of 1 Corinthians 13, the love spoken of there is not primarily love towards God, is it? That's why it's called the love chapter. That's why people read it at their weddings, because they look at it and recognize that what 1 Corinthians 13 tells us is how to treat one another in love. So in 1 Thessalonians, when Paul talks about labor that is prompted by love, he's not talking about prompted by love towards God. He's talking about love towards one another. And so this phrase that is one which has been transferred into our regular vernacular. We use this terminology all the time when we talk about somebody and say, that was a labor of love. Now, when you think of someone who's performed a labor of love, what type of labor do you think it is? See, here's a clue. It's not golf. You know, I can just see how that's going to go over. I'm going to have this labor of love. I'm going to go golf all afternoon. Now, it might be a labor of love for my wife to let me golf, but it's not a labor of love for me to golf. I think of diapers. Anybody like changing diapers? Raise your hand up high, because we're looking for some volunteers for the nursery. Particularly like changing the diapers of somebody else's kid. You know, I have six kids. I've changed the diapers on six kids. I have five grandkids. I don't change the grandkids' diapers. I don't know. It's just kind of a weird thing. I kind of think that's their parents' responsibility. Now, I realize I'm not a grandma. Grandma's changed diapers on grandchildren. Grandfathers try not to change diapers ever. We try never to change diapers. But when we do, it is a labor of love. You understand the concept, right? It's doing something for somebody else that you wouldn't really want to do. It's doing something for someone else because you love them and maybe they don't want to do it. It is those things that your spouse does for you, and you realize, man, I am so thankful. I was talking with one couple yesterday, and for their whole married life, the husband has only had to do laundry for like 1 or 2 weeks. That is a woman who has had an incredible labor of love for 40 years or 50 years, however long they've been married. Just gets up and does it. You know, any of you women just love the idea it's laundry day? Because if you really love that idea, you can come to our house and do laundry. See, the thing is that we have this idea that there are certain things that we just sort of think, well, those are the roles that you're supposed to fall into. And frankly, a lot of the roles that we fall into aren't necessarily things that we like to do. We do them because we love one another. Those are labors of love. Out of love for another person, we do things that they don't want to do themselves, and sometimes things that we don't want to do ourselves. But we do them because we love one another. Paul says the church at Thessalonica was known for their labors of love. Now, I believe he's going to take this even further. We're going to see this later on in the book of 1 Thessalonians, that Paul's not merely talking about those distasteful tasks which you do because you love somebody else, but also he's talking about people who get up in the morning and go to work. Because part of what was happening in the church in Thessalonica is that there were individuals who were willing to let other people support them, that they didn't go to work. They just, well, the church is supposed to have all things in common, so I'm going to let you have your things in common with me. And Paul is going to commend them and say, you know, I appreciate the fact that you people go to work so that you don't have to rely upon others to provide your daily food. Elsewhere in Scripture, he talks about it in terms of if a person doesn't work, neither should he eat. It is part of what used to be called the Christian ethic, that we were hardworking because we took care of ourselves, and for those who could not take care of themselves, we took care of them. But our society has in many ways gotten to a point where we'll take care of anybody who just doesn't want to work. That's not the biblical mandate. And Paul says if out of love for one another, we ought to take care of our own responsibilities. So he has this admonition to have labor prompted by love. And it's part of the evidence of what it means to be a believer. And finally, Paul says, you have endurance, which is inspired by hope. 1 Thessalonians was written 51-52 AD, approximately 20 years after the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus, who said in John, I'm going to prepare a place for you, and if I go to prepare a place for you, you know I'm going to come back and get you and receive you unto myself. Jesus, who said that the way you saw me ascend into heaven, the same way you're going to see me descend with the shout and the sound of the trumpet, is now 20 years later. And Jesus has not yet returned. Now, of course, we're a couple thousand years later, but at this point, there was a pretty good expectation Jesus should be returning any time. But he hasn't. Now, I want you to think in your own life about promises that have been made to you. Other than the promise made to you on your wedding day, can you think of any promise that was made 20 years ago which has not been acted upon? My parents, were interesting gift givers. They would always tell you what they were going to give you. And so when I graduated from college, it was 1979, I graduated from college, and I was pretty sure I was going to go on into seminary, and my parents said, for your college graduation present, we're going to give you the International Standard Bible Encyclopedia. It's a four-volume work. It cost about $100 at the time. It's a great little encyclopedia that you can look up anything in. It's a great resource for pastors, for people who are doing any kind of serious Bible study. In short, it's called ISBE, International Standard Bible Encyclopedia. That was in 1979. And I graduated from seminary in 1985, and I still didn't have it. I went to my first church, went 5 years there, still didn't have it. And so sometime around 1995, I went to my parents, and they told me, oh, we're going to get that for you, we're going to get that for you. Sometime around 1995, I said, you don't have to worry about it, I got it. I went out and bought it. I finally just said, I gave up hope that my parents would give me that gift. That was where my parents gave gifts. We meant to get you something, and you know what that meant is that they meant to tell me they were going to give me something, because telling me they were going to give it to them was the same as giving it to me. So it was weird. I gave up hope. It got to the point where I just, my parents said they were giving me something, I didn't even listen to them. 20 years, these people have been thinking Jesus is coming back. It's going to be a theme which is going to be repeated throughout the book. How do you respond to the fact that Jesus has said he's coming, but he's not here yet? How do we know that we're not missing something? How do we know we missed the rapture? What's going on with that? But Paul says at the very beginning, here's the thing. You have endurance which is inspired by hope. It's not the kind of hope that I had when my parents said, I'm going to give you something. Because the kind of hope that I had when my parents said they'd give me something was the hope that the package was there at that time. And if it wasn't there, there was no hope I was getting it. The kind of hope that the people had, that the church has, is a hope which is not of an uncertain future, but of an absolute guarantee of a future. That Jesus, when we saw this on Resurrection Sunday, we saw that Jesus who said he would rise again from the dead is the same Jesus who said he's coming back again. And because he is powerful enough to rise from the dead, he is powerful enough to come back again. We have a hope in the future which is rock solid. It is guaranteed. It is an absolute certainty, not a bit of wishful thinking. And things change when you have that absolute certainty, don't they? If you have ever watched a delayed broadcast of a football game that you already know the result of, your team, you know the end score is that your team has won, and you're listening to the game, you don't even worry about what the score is in the first quarter, second quarter, the third quarter. You don't worry what the score is with 2 minutes left, because if you know that at the end of the game the score is going to be in your team's favor, you can just go through it all. You know, it takes out the emotional ups and downs, doesn't it? One of the reasons that I love watching sports and one of the reasons I hate watching sports is that I have a team I'm rooting for and they do something stupid and the other team scores and then they're doing really good and we're jumping up. This is up and down and up and down. And if you know what the final score is, then it just evens out those emotions. You have endurance. You have patience. And you know that they may be down now, but I know what the end score is. When I was in college, I played on the soccer team, and we had a game that we played that was away. It was my freshman year, so the varsity team was playing, and they broadcast the game in a delay, and I forget why they had a delay broadcast, but it was a long time ago, and they didn't have instant stuff then, but you had phones. So they had this, they're broadcasting the game, and in the first half of the game, our team was winning 1-0. So finishes the first half 1-0. Soccer, 1-0, you can win a game. A lot of games are 1-0 games, and we're all excited about it. And then one of the guys called because the game was over, and he explained that in the second half the other team had the wind at their back and they scored 6 goals. And it was really interesting because word spread through all the freshman soccer players, we lost 6-1, and we all just turned off the radio. The hope of the first half was shattered. You know what? It's the other way around for us. So we've read to the end of the book. We know that we have a hope in the future, that all the bad things that happen on earth, all the times when it seems that evil has gotten the upper hand, all the times when it seems as though God is missing, he's been expelled from schools, he's been expelled from the public discourse, all the times it seems as though Satan is winning, we recognize that that's exactly what the Bible said was going to happen. And the emotional ups and downs and the fear for the future and the depression when what I understand this. Why are we depressed when what the Bible said would happen actually happens? We get really discouraged about that. We're like, yeah, big deal. The church, those who understand the hope that we have for the future, they have this endurance, this patience, this expectation, which is a part of what it means to be a living believer in Jesus Christ, where we recognize that we have an absolute hope for the future. And that means that today, whatever happens today, whether it's something which is wonderful by the world standards or something horrible by the world standards, we know that it really doesn't make a lot of difference. Because we have this expectation and this endurance, which is inspired by that blessed hope that Jesus is coming again. So Paul, he wants to give you a challenge today. Well, okay, I want to give you a challenge. I'm going to give it through Paul So, because I come to the end of a message and I often have on my notes, YBSW. Yeah, but so what? You know, yeah, but so what? So he's written to them, he's admonished them for their faith and for their work, which is prompted by faith and their labor of love and their endurance. So what? Now here's the so what. This is what I'm going to I'll give you a little homework assignment. See, Paul is actually admonishing them for their belief. And so here's what I suggest. You take each of those and you say, okay, if I was going to write a little letter, and I encourage you, write a little letter to yourself. Paul today, if Paul was today going to commend me for my work, which is produced by faith, he would commend me specifically for what? So maybe you would say, and I suggest, don't just be satisfied with just one thing. Say, if Paul was going to say, you know, I commend you for your work produced by faith, I'd say, well, one of the things I did is that my ministry, my service today to Christ, was I showed up this morning. There were lots of other things I could have done this morning. I didn't come here just because it was my job. As a matter of fact, coming here because it's a job is a really lousy reason to be a pastor. I do it because it's God's calling on me. So I, you know, for me, I'd put my work produced by faith today included preaching. And I'd say my work produced by faith involved a willingness to accept what the Scripture said, even though at sometimes I have questions about it. So right, it's a three-part assignment, right? The first one is, what are your, you know, write down, my works produced by faith are, my labor prompted by love is. These are the things which I do, not because I really like doing them, but because I love someone. And this is the way that I show my patience, inspired by the hope that Jesus is coming again. What if someone was going to write an obituary and say, you know, they had these three qualities, and you could see these three qualities in these ways. Write that for yourself. Do it as an encouragement to yourself, because what you'll find is you'll have this sense of assurance that this thing we call faith in Jesus Christ has impacted your everyday life. Let's pray. Father, I ask that you would help us today to live in such a way that our works, our labor, and our endurance is evident to those around us because we have faith, love, and hope. Amen.